Hello, and thank you for tuning in to the Final Draft Write On podcast. I'm Pete D'Alessandro, your host and product manager here at Final Draft. This is the screenwriting podcast where we talk about all things filmmaking. Our guest today is John Fusco. John Fusco is a screenwriter known for Young Guns, The Babe, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, The Sword of Destiny, and Hildago. Today, he'll be telling us about his new movie on Netflix, The Highwaymen. John Fusco, welcome to Write On.
Hey, Pete. Great to be with you today.
So I wanted to start with the beginning of your career. Obviously, if you look at your bio, it's an interesting start to a writing career. You want to talk us through how you got into storytelling?
Sure. Storytelling is really my earliest love. When I think back to it, and probably because it was such a love, it was the one thing I was good at an early age, and the one thing that gave me a lot of encouragement from people around me, teachers. And so I used to, 10 years old, I would fill these black and white composition notebooks with short stories, and I would write compulsively. I'd get up before my family got up, and that's a habit I've kept up all these years. But I would start writing very early and just disappear into story world. And I loved story building and creating. And that led to my interest in filmmaking and cinematic storytelling, which I pursued via Super 8 film. And I would take the family Super 8 camera, wrangle up the kids in the neighborhood, and direct them in my short scripts. So that started very early on, and it was something that I committed to, and I just felt this is what I want to do in my life. And at a certain point, because of the community I grew up in, kind of a blue-collar community and family background, that was writing, filmmaking was just something people didn't make a living at. Right. And so at a certain point, I felt I was there was no outlet for it, and I was frustrated. I ended up taking my love for writing and segueing into writing song lyrics for garage bands. And because no one really liked to sing in those garage bands, I ended up singing, taught myself an instrument. And the next thing I knew, I dropped out of high school and went on the road playing music. After doing that for quite a few years, I had this epiphany on the road that I had abandoned my deepest love and the thing that I was meant to do, and that the songwriting was cool and it was bringing me a lot of creative satisfaction. But I just did some soul searching and realized that I never should have let go of it. And I made up my mind I was going to circle back around, go to night school, get a GED, start from the beginning, and I was going to pursue screenwriting.
Wow, and there it went. I mean, you got that GED, you went to NYU at Tisch. How did that work out? How did the beginning of that career land after that?
I got the GED, and then it was increments to kind of work my way up to NYU, you know. So I started with community college and just hyper focused on the writing and putting in a lot of time. I was working in my father's junkyard, sawmills, doing whatever I had to do, and then got into a liberal arts college down in Florida, where I had the good fortune of meeting some great writers who had retired in Florida, as people often do. And Jack Hunter, who wrote the novel The Blue Max, and had exposure to some really successful writers who gave me strong advice and encouragement. And then I applied to NYU, the dramatic writing program at Tisch School of the Arts, and got in. So once I was in Tisch, again, I worked tending bar in New York City, and just focused and gave it everything I had on the screenwriting. And I had a professor who was very supportive of my work, and he encouraged me to enter my first screenplay in a competition called Focus, Films of College and University Students. That was kind of like the Nichols Fellowship of the time. And it was awesome. I mean, it was sponsored by Nissan. They had categories for everything from acting to sound achievement, directing. And I remember going down that list, and it was the very, very last one on the list, screenwriting. And I got the script in, and it won first place. So I was flown out to LA for the first time in my life. I was given a new Nissan automobile, and which I sold to continue going to school, because although I signed with William Morris on that trip, the script did not sell, and I was back to tending bar. But I was now even more fired up. I had that kind of validation, and I started work on my second screenplay, and I did that in a master's class that was taught by, and you're going to love this, Pete, it was taught by three teachers all at once. Waldo Salt, who won the Oscar for Midnight Cowboy, Coming Home, wrote Serpico. Ring Lardner Jr., who won the Oscar for MASH, and Ian McClellan Hunter. So three screenwriting masters from the McCarthy era, you know, part of the Hollywood 17, you know, the larger group of blacklisted artists. And I benefited from all three, but Waldo really took me under his wing, and that was because he connected with my background, with this kind of unorthodox background. You know, I'd been on the road from the time I was 17 until I was 21.
Wow.
And so that was really my high school. And Waldo, who had hoboed with Woody Guthrie and had been in the military and had a great life of experience, he connected with the script I was working on, which was called Crossroads. And it was a road story about a young white musician who had a passion for the blues and befriended an old obscure blues man and headed off on an odyssey down south. And so Waldo gave me a lot of support on that one. He wrote Midnight Cowboy. You know, so he said, look, nobody's writing road movies in film school. And so he encouraged me to stick to my guns on it. And by the time I finished the script, well, the Focus Awards were accepting applications again. So I submitted Crossroads. And again, I won first place. And this was, now the submissions were up to about 1,200 scripts. And so I was flown out to LA and given another Nissan automobile. And this one I got to keep because the script sold to Columbia Pictures on spec. Again, this was the roaring 80s when these big spec sales were happening. So it became a game changer for me, a life changer. And I had a lot of people saying, wow, I mean, that was like an overnight success. And I said, oh, no, you weren't with me in the sawmills and jumping trains from 17 to 21. And I think all that material found its way into my writing. And I graduated from Tisch, but I actually was on the set of my first movie down in the Mississippi Delta, where only a few years earlier I had been hitchhiking. And I was shooting the movie with Walter Hill directing and Ralph Macchio in the lead role. And more importantly to me, all the music heroes that I dreamed I would have one day met through my music were working on this movie. So I have Ry Cooter, Arlen Roth, Frank Frost, Stevie Vai, Jim Dickinson. I mean, it was just, and then my all-time blues hero, Sonny Terry. So it was amazing, and NYU gave me, they designed a course, which I think was called like internship with Walter Hill, and that was like for my final credits. And so I was able to graduate, but I had my first movie.
Wow, that's amazing. What happened there? I mean, most of the time you get that one movie, get that one thing that goes on, it's usually not a total upward slope. Were there ups and downs after that for a while?
You know, it's a great question, Pete, because I remember when I got that movie made feeling, you know what, no matter what else happens in life, I got a movie made. And I know it's hard to do. And I had signed with agents and they advised that I move out to LA, and I did. And I went out there and the script was, had a lot of fans in town. So, you know, I was 25 years old and making the rounds and getting offers for development deals, but I couldn't really connect with the type of material being offered to me. Hmm. And my agents, being good, wise agents, said, look, this is an opportunity that doesn't come around. And you really want to look at these offers and you want to start developing stuff with big studios. But I got frustrated with the material. I developed a few things and got into the so-called development hell of it all. And I felt frustrated. So I had a meeting with my agents and said, I want to leave town. I'm finding that I'm writing for 4 months where I don't have to see anyone or do lunches. And why can't I do that anywhere? And I'm going to move into a log cabin up in the mountains where I can have horses and live the kind of life I want. And I want to write on spec. And I remember seeing the color drain from their faces. And they said, well, okay, moving out of town, it's just something screenwriters don't do, especially early on in their careers. But if you're set on that, okay, but what are you going to write on spec? And I said, a Western. And then they went, you know, a wider shade of pale. And they said, you do know that the biggest running joke in Hollywood is about somebody's going off to write a Western. And that the Western's been dead for 20 years. No Western has made money since Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. And I said, I just feel really strongly about this, guys. And just let me give it a go. Because I really believe in this one. And creatively, it's where I want to be. So I moved off into the mountains. And I started researching and writing this script called Young Guns. And when I submitted it and turned it into them, they responded very positively, and they said, oh, wait, we didn't know you were writing this kind of Western. You know, this is really interesting. And they kind of put a high concept spin on it, but I mean, that wasn't why I wrote it. But it did indeed attract all of the young stars of the time. I remember it was, people had referred to it as the Brat Pack on horseback. You know, that I didn't care for that slogan, but we attracted, I mean, even, you know, Sean Penn. I remember Sean Penn read it while he was in jail for a paparazzi incident. He wanted to do it. Tom Cruise. I mean, literally every one of these young stars wanted to get on horseback and do an American Western. And so we put together this cast with Emilio Estevez and Kiefer Sutherland and Charlie Sheen and, you know, right down the line, Lou Diamond and Phillips. It went out on spec and sold like overnight. Wow. And it became a hit. It opened number one. And my agent said, stay up in the mountains and start writing the sequel. and I did. And the sequel became a hit. And I think that decision, Pete, where I could have kind of stayed in town and kept hammering at the development deals, that was a kind of critical crossroads, no pun intended. I think that choice to go off and be true to myself as a writer is what kept it going on an upward slope. And it's, you know, 34 years now of a consistent career living out of town and writing the stuff I want to write. It's not to say that there have not been ups and downs throughout. And there have been some damn hard times in the industry where I've had to kind of dig deep into the well of the types of material that speak to me to make sure that I could get stuff made.
John, the thing that occurs to me about this is, I mean, it really is a risk. You kind of ignored the advice of your agents on multiple fronts there and said, I'm going to go do this thing that no one thinks I should do. Feels like, obviously, looking back, if you hadn't taken that risk, not taking the risk probably would have been a bigger risk. But how do you know? How do you weigh when one thing is right over the other?
I talk to young writers about this all the time, and it's, you really do have to be true to yourself as a writer and your passions, because that's when you're going to do writing that is next level. You know, Waldo Salt, I remember him telling me, he said, you know, we writers have to be true to ourselves, and that's always going to be hard. And if we're good, we'll always be in trouble, and let's be sure we deserve it. And I think, you know, I always remember Waldo's words. And right after Young Guns 2, I was getting, you know, a lot of offers. And I didn't just close the door on development deals. If something hit the access code for me and I found a way into it, then I would pursue it. And one of those things came up right away, and TriStar wanted to develop a Native American action movie. And as soon as I heard Native American, I wanted to go meet with them and see what they had in mind. And I did not respond to their take on it. But I realized at that point, no one was making Native American movies. This was pre-Dances with Wolves. And I felt it was an opportunity because it's something I care deeply about. From an early age, I've been very interested and committed to Native American affairs and politics, history, philosophy, and the spiritual depth of Native American way. So I felt this is an opportunity and I don't want to just walk out on it. Let me see if I can turn them around. So I kind of, I repitched it. I think what they were looking for was Native American cop goes to LA, meets an LA cop, and, you know, it's an all out actioner and, you know, all the stereotypes of what they believe the Native American should be. Mm. And what I did was I made the decision to take the job. And now, this is in the area of high risk again, Pete, and I don't necessarily recommend it. But I felt so strongly that I could convince them via proof of concept that I would take the risk.
Wow.
And if what I turned in, if they ultimately said, that's not what we asked for, we're not going to pay you, I don't know. I felt I'm going to go off, have my 4 months, which I spent entirely on a Native American reservation in South Dakota.
Wow.
And I wrote a screenplay called Thunderheart, and it had nothing to do with a Native cop going to LA. It was all set on the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation, and it deeply explored the turbulent period of the 1970s when the FBI were occupying the Pine Ridge Reservation and waging war against insurgents and activists, and which led to abuses of traditional people and elders, and it all linked to mineral resources and the same old age-old Indian wars. So I created a great Native American cop, I could say that, but it was a whole different scene, and Val Kilmer, you know, would eventually play the FBI agent who was sent to the res. Well, I turned that script in, and I got the call from the studio, and they said, this is nothing like what we asked for, but we absolutely love it. we love it. And so I started meetings with them, and they pushed back and tried to kind of manipulate it and said, can we now, instead of like a government intrigue related to uranium strip mining, can it be cocaine and casinos? And can it be a little more lethal weapon? I said, no. Once you go down this road, you can't do it. This script stayed alive and became a back and forth for 5 years.
Wow.
Before it got made. During that time, I reached out just on a gut feeling to Robert De Niro. And De Niro and I had met once in the past, and he had a real interest in upcoming writers. And he was interested in my stuff. So I sent it to him, to his people, and got a call right away. And he asked me to come to New York. And I went to his home. I went to his place and sat up on the rooftop with him. And he looked at me with that De Niro look. And he said, are you telling me that this shit has gone on as recently as the 1970s. I said, it's going on at some level today, Bob. Or I didn't call him Bob back then, but, you know, it went on through the 80s. And this is why I've been sticking with it for five. This story has got to be told. And he said, can you take me there? Can you show me these people and show me this thing? And I said, yeah. So I really admire him and his son, Raphael, who was 12 years old at the time. They flew to South Dakota on a private plane. And I picked them up in a van full of chain smoking Lakota guys. And we drove onto the res, which is, 80 miles east of Rapid City. And it's the most impoverished reservation in the most impoverished county in the United States. Hmm. So they got an eye opener, and they spent 3 days. And De Niro came to meet the highest ranking ceremonial chief in the nation. His name was Chief Fool's Crow, who was a legend. And he met another, I took him to meet another medicine man, and he did the sweat lodge ceremony with all of us. And he went and met the real people who inspired the story. And he left shaking my hand and said, "We're going to get this thing made." And he went and he used his clout and cred at TriStar. And I think he committed as an actor. I think he gave a blind commitment to making a movie as an actor for them to produce this movie. And he produced it with me, he, Jane Rosenthal, and I. And it became the first Tribeca film ever made.
Wow.
We finally got it shot with Michael Apted directing. And it's a movie that I still care deeply about and very proud of.
Wow, that's incredible. Well, look, I know we have to move on to talking about The Highwaymen. So let's get into that. How did The Highwaymen come to you? Where did this start?
Well, it's an interesting segue because I haven't felt this strongly about a movie since Thunderheart. Hmm. And I think it's interesting that they're both rural Americana, in a way, kind of slow-burning thrillers based on true stories that have been hidden or buried. I've always had an interest in outlaws and gangsters, as you might tell by looking at my And when I saw the 1967 Arthur Penn movie Bonnie and Clyde, and I was in my pajamas at the drive-in with my parents, you know, great, great family movie, right? I was blown away by the movie. So I guess you could say part of that generation that was turned on by that movie that changed Hollywood. And it absolutely has been an influence on my career. However, when I went and researched Bonnie and Clyde more deeply because of that movie, I found that historically they were not the glamorous Warren Beatty and Faye Dunaway, and that they were hardcore criminals who killed a lot of people, and that the antagonist in the movie, the Texas Ranger Frank Hamer, was portrayed as an absolute mustache-twirling buffoon. Mm-hmm. And when I researched who he really was, man, that was not just historically off the mark. It was an injustice.
Right.
And, you know, because this guy, I mean, he was the true hero of the story and a true American hero, considered one of the greatest law officers of the 20th century and a really humble, quiet guy who didn't want publicity and just, you know, took on hard jobs and from the early days as an old-time Texas Ranger. So as I dug deeper into his story, I found that when the movie came out in 67, his son, Frank Jr., and his widow, Gladys, sued Warner Brothers for character defamation and won a large out-of-court settlement.
Huh.
So I felt, you know, it's time that the other side of the story is told and Frank Hamer gets his day in court. And not only that, it's an awesome story. I mean, a Texas Ranger retired who's pulled back out into an era that has passed him by to make the transition from horse and Winchester to motorized car and machine rifle and hunt down modern day gangsters. It's a great story in itself.
There's this perfect mythology of that, you know, the retired gunslinger having to come out of retirement to save this, you know, this one situation, to right this one wrong.
Oh, yes.
And it really taps into that.
It does. I mean, I think it's kind of the real Western iconography. And so that resonates. But I went and I said, I won't go write this movie unless I get the blessing of Frank Jr. because of all the pain the family went through.
Mm.
And he would not take calls from me, from a Hollywood screenwriter, until I did deeper research on him and found that he was once a game warden. I had game warden contacts from some earlier research on a project. They called him for me, vouched for me. I got a call from Frank Hamer Jr. and he said, "Come on down to Austin, I'll buy you a steak." And I went down there and we sat in a steakhouse with the Hamer family posse, like six Hamer nephews and grandkids and, you know, some tough Austin boys. We drank bourbon and he looked at me and said, "What's on your mind, kid?" And I told him what I just told you. And by the end of the day, we walked out and he said, "My father would never want a movie done about him because he wasn't that type of guy. But this story does need to be told. And everything you told me makes me feel that you're the one to do it. So I just ask one thing, do right by my daddy." And so I went and I wrote The Highwaymen, That was 16 years ago.
Wow. Wow.
And we got Paul Newman and Robert Redford on board to play the two roles. And that was the talk of the town, obviously. And I thought I was heading toward an ultimate career highlight. I was working with Redford and Newman on the script, then Paul got sick. And so when that package fell apart, where do you go from there, from the view of the studios? And so it sat for 16 years until Kevin Costner and Woody Harrelson got to the right age. And man, they just kill it. They just knock it out of the park.
They do. They do. So what made this start going forward when it started to happen?
Well, John Lee Hancock, incredible director, great writer in his own right. He had been attached to direct at the same time Redford and Newman came on board. So he's been on it for 13 years. So he's a newcomer to it, you know. But Casey Silver, the producer, and man, I got to tell you, he's been, if every writer could have a producer like that in their lives, who gets your work and protects it and becomes your partner, man, you're in good shape. He's been with me a long time. Well, he kept after it. He never let the script go. He knew that it had a lot of respect in town, and he kept it going until this amazing thing called Netflix lined up. And because I had just come off a Netflix series that I created, Marco Polo, and Casey just came off Godless, which he produced, and we felt it only made sense to take our Labor of Love project with John Lee Hancock, Kevin, and Woody to Netflix. And bam, we were off to the races.
Wow. So there it is.
Yep.
So how does this work when you guys start shooting? How does it start to unfold?
Through these years, we kept the script alive, like John Lee and I kicking it back and forth and talking about theme. And there's just something about by not just making phone calls, but kind of keeping it creatively alive that we felt we were going to will it into existence. Mm-hmm. So when it started shooting in Louisiana, I went down and I was on set. And John Lee is just such a brilliant director, and he has a beautiful sense of restraint, and, you know, to make what I would call a grown-up movie, master of the slow burn, just committed to the integrity of the material and the dialogue and character, never feeling like he's got a gun to his head. We've got to shoehorn in action. So he approached it in the right way. And it was an amazing, haunting experience. I say haunting because we shot the thing right down where all this stuff happened. In fact, the ambush scene is shot. I know it's not a spoiler because everyone knows where this goes. But
it's been 80 years, yeah.
Yeah, the ambush scene was shot at the exact spot on the exact road in the exact ditch that the car rolled into.
Wow.
And the only thing we had to do was cover the paved road with dirt. Nothing else has changed. And so it was, I have to say, like Thunderheart, it was something that I put all my heart and soul into, never gave up on. And the day came that it got made in a way that made it worth waiting for the writer.
Wow. Some of the big choices, I mean, that just occurred to me as I watched this, there are two kind of big stories where, flashback is not the right word, but it could potentially have been done as a flashback, where we're listening to either character, either Manny or Pancho, kind of recite like this very formative moment for them. And it's one of the more interesting choices, because I think there's a lot of ways that could have been done, but this is a straight speech that is compelling, but how do you know that that's the choice? And did you try other stuff in that place?
Yeah, and that is a great question, Pete, because when I did the first draft, I was a bit overambitious because I was so taken by the big epic story of Frank Hamer's life and career. Mm. I mean, there were so many pivotal moments that aligned with big historical episodes. And I mean, because, you know, he went through the bandit wars on the border, horseback, went through prohibition, you know, was friends with Pancho Villa. He took on the Ku Klux Klan. He took on the KKK. He led the war against the KKK in Texas. Wow. He rescued at least 15 African-American men from lynch mobs in documented accounts. So it was a massive amazing story. And what I did was I wrote Cradle to the Grave, and I wrapped it around the pursuit for Bonnie and Clyde. And so these big moments would be triggered by something during the hunt for Bonnie and Clyde that would go back to flashback.
So that would sort of be the framing device.
Yes. And okay. I think to your point, those scenes, those monologue scenes you pointed out, were dramatized in that draft. Mm-hmm. And they were put on their feet, and we saw them worked out. And eventually, when Casey Silver and I recognized that the script was a bit unwieldy, and maybe because this was before the idea of limited series came along, we said, we want this thing to be a feature, and I think we've got to commit to the pursuit for Bonnie and Clyde and just strip it down. And what I found was that when we took that approach, making it a two-hander in earnest, and we got to those moments that might have triggered the flashback, I committed to monologues. And I've been so pleased that those monologues have been singled out.
Right.
And that are getting great buzz and being looked at like, hey, you don't see a whole lot of this anymore, where you have the confidence in the writing, let the writing carry it. Look, when you have Kevin Costner, Woody Harrelson, you're a fortunate guy. But I don't think I could have written those monologues the way that I did if I had not dramatized them on the page.
Wow.
And so I now look at that as, man, that was a useful exercise. because it really, I feel I lived with Hamer through that scene when he's 16 and he wanted to be a preacher. And, that's a pretty big, I think that was, 12 minutes of script. I think to shrink that down into a monologue in a gas station could be really daunting. But I felt like I know this story inside out. I've written it on the page. And so that it was a useful exercise.
I really see why that worked now. I was curious about that. Glad I asked. What about there are a couple different themes run through this, and I think there's a character arc that I really wanted to explore a little bit about Manny's character. I mean, Woody Harrelson's character starts out as someone who he looks around and says, I have nothing to lose. I might as well go on this journey. And I hope I'm interpreting this right, but as the movie goes on, he realizes that was not true. I did not have it as bad as I thought I did. So how did you guys explore that? How early did that come into the process?
I knew that Manny Gault was going to be a key component in this thing. As soon as I sat down and met with Frank Hamer Jr., and he told me Manny's backstory and how he was the one guy that Hamer trusted and who he went to get and have him ride with him on this kind of ride the high country, lonesome dove, last cattle drive, I think the thing is that both of these guys had a terrible gift. They were early Texas Rangers who were known as manhunters or man killers, who were brought out for the really hard cases and sent into dangerous situations, whether Borgia or Mexia or Navasota, dangerous, dangerous towns to go in and do some terrible acts to counter terrible acts. And that was the thing. There were people who had to be stopped, killers, rapists, and bad, bad people. So they had a terrible gift for being able to end these types of reigns of terror. And they carried that weight with them. And so now they've got to come out and do it one more time, and they don't feel good about it. And in a way, so for Manny and his arc, what he's really, they're hunting Bonnie and Clyde, but they're really hunting his own demons. And coming full circle back to that friendship with Frank. But that monologue that he does about that incident, Manos Erebus, that's what I called it in my notes. The Manos Erebus is a true story, and it was a really dark wound, but one that they had committed to. It was a life way they chose. So it's the Manny character was really important, and Woody just got it. And I think what Woody brings to it up front, to tee it up, is something few actors can really do.
You mentioned that now, and I realized that the whole arc that I interpreted there was probably just a series of little looks on his face as they drove past someone.
Oh, man. Yeah. And at that moment, when he delivers that line about the 14-year-old boy, he rides out on a mule that he accidentally shot, and he said, I still see his face.
Right.
And you're on Woody's face, and you, man, I know. It's just, you know, we had two actors who put their trust in the words and brought to it all their next level skills as actors who really believed in these characters. And when that happens, it's you know, it makes you feel like this is why we do this. This is, you know, what we work so damn hard toward.
There's the other arc I'd like to get into a little bit too, if we have time. Frank's arc, you know, the Mano Cerebus is sort of the culmination of it, but he has this past where he has done things not by the book and has done the way, does a couple things and killed a couple people in the way that the bad guys would, shooting somebody in the back, even though they probably deserved it, not going in with hands up as your rating chant.
Right.
He's done these things. And then in the end, I mean, he has this motivation or this desire to do this one thing right, despite that this is by far the most dangerous moment to take that
yes.
moral stand. So how did that come about?
That's the thing, is that Frank, he did not want to go do this job. And I think that the more that he tracked them and got into their heads, he saw such violence. And so, I mean, and it's something that is always lost in this are the victims' families, the people who yeah. were left behind, the law officers who were shot. And this is by no means some sort of anthem about unorthodox police ways or
no.
some real romanticizing, you know, misconduct. I myself have been the victim of kind of misconduct in my younger days. But, you know, Hamer was that type of guy. You know, there's a samurai saying, if I can do my Kurosawa John Ford cycle of influence, there's a samurai saying, no one loves a warrior till there's trouble at the gate. And J. Edgar Hoover was trying to catch Bonnie and Clyde for 2 years with a 1,000-man dragnet, couldn't do it. No one was able to do it, and Hamer did not want to do it. You know, and a lot of it was the girl. There's a girl in there, and they're not stopping, and they've made it clear they're not going to stop. Someone's going to have to shoot these young kids who are like natural-born killers. And after, I think at that point, it was the seventh law officer shot at a roadblock. He said, okay, I know how to do this, and it's incumbent upon me to go out and stop these two. But as he told Lee Simmons, you know you're going to have to put them on the spot. And he said, yeah, that's what's going to have to happen. Yeah, it all builds up to Mano Cerebus, and they, at a certain point, when do killers stop deserving another chance at surrender? If they just keep, if they're going to kill you and they've made it clear, you're not taking me without a gunfight. But what's happened in that moment, that is the moment that, and people ask me, they say, well, there's the Arthur Penn version, you know, the slow motion balletic death scene, which is legendary in cinema, where they're just ambushed from the woods. And of course, in that movie, the motivation is Hamer's revenge. And it's as brilliant as it is, it's, you know, wrong historically.
Yeah.
And again, an injustice. There's no one's around today from those six guys at the ambush who can arbitrate it. But what I committed to, and through the writing, like early on, I told Casey, I said, you know, when in doubt, I go to Hamer's notes that I had access to. I go to Hamer's only two interviews he ever gave, one with Walter Prescott Webb, the chronicler of Texas Rangers history. And Hamer's version was, and we do know this was the plan. It was, you know, if you look at all the depositions and things like that, that Hamer was going to step out and get them to surrender.
Yeah.
And if they went for their guns, that's when the five guys in the bushes were going to hit him. And so in Hamer's own words, he said he stepped out and said, stick him up. And when Kevin read, you know, Kevin said, he really said, stick him up. And I said, that's what he claims to have said. And
wow.
And this is Hamer's day in court. So if it's the Rashomon of it, you know, we're, you know, moving the camera over here and you know, Hamer's, but it is character arc wise. it was like that moment of maybe I die here. And they reached for their guns. And at the end, when you see the newsreel footage of that shot up car and they're unloading it, well, they found three fully loaded Browning automatic rifles with, you know, loaded with armor piercing ammo stolen from a military base, two shotguns fully loaded, 10 Colt automatic pistols. Bonnie had a revolver taped to her upper right thigh, where they wouldn't frisk her, and they had over 3,000 rounds of ammunition. It was a rolling arsenal that had to be shot. But yeah, I would say that at the end of the arc, there's no joy in Mudville. And I think that moment when Hamer's approached by the press, which was true, and he's offered $1,000 just to get on the phone and walks away, turns off the radio. Well, you know, because all that stuff with the car, the death car being paraded through Arcadia on that day, when John Lee and I were asked if we exaggerated that, and John Lee said, no, we toned it down.
Oh, my God.
People went mad. The population swelled in the town, and they raised the prices on cigarettes. It was like Woodstock. And
wow.
Hamer left that, and when he got home, he heard from the governor that they were going to have a Hamer Galt Hero Day with parades through the street and a big dinner and medals. And he said no. And he and Galt said no. In fact, Manny never gave an interview.
Wow.
So, yeah, it's and what Hamer, you know, went back. Tom Mix offered Hamer $10,000 for his movie rights.
Wow.
And Hamer said, no, you know, you're doing all right playing, you know, your own cowboys. You don't want to do my story. And he did not like the limelight. It was just the job he had to do.
Right. I happen to be great at it.
Yep.
John, I know we have to wrap up. One last quick question, if I can. Looking back now, we don't have a lot of time to get into your writing process, but looking back now, what do you incorporate into your writing process that you wouldn't have known to do long ago?
You know, I have to say that nothing has really changed from the start, which again is, you know, I get up before 5 every morning.
Wow.
And yep, and it's like a mojo, a superstition, or just a commitment, or maybe it's the blue collar ethic I grew up with. But I start writing and that early, and I start from page one every day. And wow. some people, you know, or I've read screenwriting books, or you know, where people say if you do that, you're doomed to never finish. Mm-hmm. For me, it's like I have to go into an editing room and watching the movie up to the point you have every single day to get that, not only a running head start to ram your head through the wall, mm-hmm. but also to get your sense of pacing and momentum. And yeah, I will change things from page one every single day as I go.
Wow.
And what used to take me, I used to write insane hours, Pete, it's because I felt I'm not as good as a lot of the writers around me. You know, at NYU, I looked around and, you know, I was intimidated, but I felt one thing that I will do is I'll make sure, damn sure, I work harder than any of them. And so I used to write from 5 in the morning, take a break midday to work out, and then come back and work till 5. So it was like full out days. Now what I found over these 34 years is I can accomplish in 4 hours what used to take me the full day. And I think what it is so there's absolutely stuff that I didn't know that I've absorbed, that I've picked up on, that's allowing me to do that. But I've just stayed really true to a blue-collar work ethic. Like Jack London used to say, you got to get up in the morning with a club and go after it and hit it over the head, wrestle it to the ground. And, you know, I do it 5 days a week. And like Mark Twain said, sometimes on Sunday when the wife's not looking.
Wow. Well, thank you, John Fusco. Thanks for being here.
Thank you for having me. Right on. It's a great podcast, and it's a real privilege to be talking with you.
Oh, thank you. You can check out The Highwaymen on Netflix now, and thank you out there to everyone who's been listening and subscribing. Thanks for leaving all those ratings and reviews on iTunes. You can stay in the know by following us on Facebook or find us on Twitter as @FinalDraftInc. We're on Instagram as @FinalDraftScreenwriting. I'm Pete D'Alessandro. Until next time, right on.